Hello and welcome to the Monthly Marquee. I'm your host, Bart Lovins, director of the Hardin County Schools Performing Arts Center. And my first two guests this month are David Hussey and Colton Smith, both of whom have just recently appeared on the stage at Derby Dinner Playhouse. Gentlemen, welcome so much.
Thank you.
Good to be here.
Really, really appreciate it. David, just tell us a little bit about your experience at Derby. What have you done there?
Wow. Well, my experience actually started through my wife, who grew up doing theater there. And then after college, she went to Boston Conservatory. She did a season there. So when we moved here 3 years ago from L.A., there were still people there that she had worked with. And I got to talk to them, and one thing led to another, and I got an audition, and they needed a tall, goofy guy who could fall down a lot. So I was Buddy the Elf 2 years ago, a Christmas show. Colton just did a Christmas show. Mm-hmm. And man, the support there, the crowds there, the people there, the family atmosphere. I had heard about it for years from my wife and her friends that I'd met, and it just it surpassed everything I thought it would be. It was a magical time. It was tough getting through that last show.
Mm.
You know what I mean?
Well, Odd Couple was the last thing.
Yeah,
yes.
So then I did Winnie the Pooh Christmas Tale the next year.
What'd you do in Winnie the Pooh?
I was Eeyore. I know. You wouldn't think it.
You were not.
I was like
Eeyore.
A crotchety old man Eeyore. I was more like Walter Matthau than the which is funny because then I played Oscar Madison in The Odd Couple whenever that was.
It's a couple, trend.
Yeah. August, September, I guess.
Nice.
And yeah, I worked with some of the same people from Elf that I did, and also a new friend that I made there had been your Sherlock Holmes at the PAC mm-hmm. in the past, but couldn't do this one, so he suggested me to you. We met, hit it off, and so now I get to be the iconic, smartest person in the room, Detective Sherlock Holmes.
Yeah.
And we're having a similarly fantastic time with these great people at the PAC in the phenomenal, phenomenal space you have.
The facility is
top notch.
Yeah. Colton, what you've been up to at Derby?
I just got done doing A Christmas Story. I was Flick. So, you know, the iconic flagpole, mm-hmm. the tongue scene, that was great to do. Really
now, I have to ask you about that, because yes. we've been doing interviews all morning. Skag Limousine's been kind enough to drive us around. Mm-hmm. And the moment hadn't opened up, so I'm going to ask you now.
Okay.
Sticking your tongue to a flagpole.
Yes.
In normal circumstances, mm-hmm. let's say, mm-hmm. pretty disgusting.
Yes.
What about with COVID?
They sanitized that a lot.
Like the pole or your tongue?
The pole.
No.
They had to sanitize it after every show because each role was double casted.
Oh my gosh.
So we had to use the same pole, me and my other cast member. We had to use the same pole, so they had to sanitize it every day because then it would just like switch and alternate between us.
I wondered about that. Mm-hmm. But a fun role.
Yes, it was very fun to hear the laughs because mm-hmm. that's what Flick does. That's all he gets for every interaction he has, really. So that was really fun.
I can attest to it. I was one of the laughers watching him do it a couple times, so he was terrific.
Well, thank David, you. Right now you're on our stage getting ready to perform as Sherlock. Like we were saying earlier, it's a dream role.
It is, yeah.
And you just got back from a trip to England.
I did.
And you did a little bit of research while you were over there. I saw from some of your photos.
I did. I sent Bart some pictures. I went to 221B Baker Street where they have the Sherlock Holmes Museum there. And yeah, just to be there, to be a part of it, to ask locals there how to pronounce some of the things that we mm-hmm. have in the show. It was a good kickoff to get into this world.
Well, and we all have dream roles. You've got a production of Little Mermaid coming yes. up right now. Mm-hmm. Is there any dream roles in that you'd be interested in?
I'm okay with any role in the show.
Smart answer.
I feel like it would just be very fun to be one of the Ursula's eels
mm-hmm.
because being like an evil role, I feel like that'll be interesting.
People our size don't get to play evil roles
yeah.
often enough.
No,
so yeah, I
not
agree
really.
With you. Yeah. And they are the fun ones. Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. And we were talking about Little Mermaid.
Yes.
That's part of Youth Theater of Hardin County.
Yes.
And they're going to be doing that show this summer. Mm-hmm. And they start off with their winter workshops for anyone who's watching and mm-hmm. may be interested. Youth Theater does winter workshop in January, which would be January the 15th. But then they do them again in February and March. And these are to prepare students for the auditions in April. So if yes. you're watching and you're interested, check the pack.net for information on these winter workshops. Did you do the winter workshops last year?
Yes.
They did help, don't you think?
They did really help because you get to understand the music that goes along and the characters a lot more for your audition.
Mm-hmm. And one of the things that you were talking about in your interview form is we talk about people being triple threats in theater. Have you heard that term before?
Yes.
You're an excellent actor, singer, and a dancer. Mm-hmm. Myself, I'm a double threat. Dance is the thing that I always have to work
I'm
on.
With
you mentioned
you there.
That too. Yeah. And that's where I think the winter workshops would help somebody like me. Mm-hmm. I feel pretty comfortable singing or talking, but dance can be scary, and I think they really help if that's
they
something
do.
That makes you nervous.
Yes, they really do.
Yeah. So you can check our website for more information about that. David, what's up next for you? We've been talking about Little Mermaid with Colton here.
Yeah, I'll be working with Kentucky Shakespeare. I'm very excited about that. We're doing an 8-person version of Henry VI, an amalgam of part 1, 2, and 3. Each of us playing multiple roles, and I get to work with the great John Huffman, who has been a dear friend for many years. My wife did the music band with him when she was a little girl. And so it's like the A-team of Kentucky Shakespeare, and I'm thrilled to be with them. So I'm very excited about that. That'll be in their indoor space, which is just a block from the park where they do their
summer show.
Will this
be the first thing they've done in the new space?
I think it's the second. They did a Halloween show, which was called... What was it called?
Something
Thorn or...
Ah!
No.
I can't think of it.
Edit it in as opposed, yeah.
It was not Shakespeare.
No.
Yes. Which but is why I can't think of it.
Yeah.
It was well-known piece
like
of literature.
Jane Austen type.
Yeah.
Turn of the Screw.
That's it.
And it was great. It was great the way they used the space. It's a big black box space, so the audience is all around, and so you can have lots of surprises with sound and appearances.
Yeah.
They did a great job. I'm excited to work in that space too, much like I'm excited to work in the fantastic space we have here. It's like being on Broadway here at the PAC.
Mm-hmm. Oh, that's very kind. And we're looking forward to seeing Sherlock in January. We're looking forward to have Youth Theater back mm-hmm. in the space with their winter workshops preparing for Little Mermaid. And thank you both very much for being here.
Thank you.
I understand you've got the time. You're going to help me co-host and interview our next guest.
Great.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Our next guest is Ms. Carrie Lewis from the Hardin County Playhouse. Carrie, it's so good to see you.
Good to see you, too. And
I
nice
like,
to
I
meet
feel
you
like
all.
We're socially distanced
we
now
are.
That I have these wonderful co-hosts with me. What is coming up at the Playhouse?
Well, our next production will be The Diary of Anne Frank.
Ooh.
So we're going to be having auditions for that January 10th and 11th at the ECTC Science Auditorium, and that's going to be at 6:30. And the production's going to be performed starting March 11th, and it'll be the 11th through the 13th, and then the 17th through the 20th. We usually do 6 or 7 shows for each show.
Colton, did you have anything you wanted to ask Carrie?
Sure. As a student myself, how can other kids like me that have interest in theater find a way to get involved?
Well, we have lots of different options for younger people. We usually do at least one show involving young students, and we usually have parts in our other shows as well. So you would need to follow us on Facebook probably, which is the Hardin County Playhouse, or our website, which is hardincountyplayhouse.com. And we have all our events that we're doing and the audition materials and stuff. It's right there for you.
And Carrie, I'm going to get the name of the project wrong. But I know you also sometimes during the year you have workshops.
Yes, we do have a summer workshop, and I'm not sure, we've been so tentatively scheduling everything because of COVID and different absences and stuff, and we have to abide by the ECTC guidelines. So there have been some restrictions there over the past year. So we will be, as we go through our season, we're now planning our next season. So we've got upcoming, we've got The Diary of Anne Frank, then we've got Heathers, the musical, coming up at the end of the season. So those are going to be two things, and we'll be looking at workshops during the summer and then planning our next season from there. So hopefully
you've been there
soon.
50 years doing this?
Oh, I was just...
Not you personally.
Baby,
but
yes,
so
in different locations.
What's the support like? I mean, the community support. I imagine there are people who've been coming there for decades.
Yes, we've had, and of course, this is a very fluid community with the military base and so forth. So
yes.
We've had a lot of people that come and go, and some that have been regulars since the very beginning. But we've had several different locations, and this is just kind of an interim location right now. We're trying to do some fundraising so that we can build a permanent, more suitable location for everything we're doing. We've got some limitations with the stage. It's a small stage at the Science Auditorium, and it doesn't have a backstage, and it doesn't have dressing rooms. So we have some challenges there, but it's all been fine, and certainly grateful to have a place to perform. But we've actually been, if we can raise the money for the new building, we have been given some land by the city. And that would be fabulous.
Terrific.
Because
So when that happens, you'll have a permanent home.
Yes. And, you know, we were just starting fundraising. That was going very well. And then COVID hit, the C word. The word we don't want to say anymore. But it slowed everything down because you cannot go and do networking and talk to people, you know, under the circumstances that we've lived under for the past couple of years. And because there have been challenges in business and people with their financial difficulties through this time, you know, it's hard to ask for money for theater at that point in time. But we're revving up, getting ready to go again.
Terrific.
I believe this is going to be a better year.
Knock on wood. Would you have?
Oh, yeah, there we go.
We got to find it first, don't we?
Now, you mentioned that you're making plans for next season.
Mm-hmm.
And I know you're probably not ready to announce that, but can you tease anything for us?
I better not. I'll probably get in trouble. But we're going to have a more full season than we've had in the past. We've got lots of, you know, and when we plan a season, we have to think about what people would be wanting to see, as well as what we can do in the space that we're in, as well as the financial aspects of it as well, because some productions are, the rights are very expensive for them. So, but yeah, we will be announcing that soon, hopefully.
Cool.
So.
And with Anne Frank coming up, it's a deep subject.
It is a very deep subject, and I think it's very relevant right now. Mm. It's always been relevant, and I think that's why it continues to be a popular play, even though it's a very thoughtful and thoughtfully provoking play, but it speaks a lot to a lot of different things, you know, and I think it's very timely.
Well, and you know, timely in so many ways, the Holocaust and everything,
right.
But I can't help but think the fact that these families and these people were isolated in this space,
right,
unable to leave.
Mm. Right.
Man, that hits home right now.
It does.
We've all experienced that on some level.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
It does. And there's been a lot of things that, you know, people take for granted, the freedoms that we enjoy in this country. We take them so for granted, and we haven't seen another side. And this brings us to light. You know, we take a lot of the comforts that we enjoy here so much for granted. So it's good to see another side. Get a different perspective.
Now, when are auditions again for Anne Frank?
They are January 10th and 11th. That's a Monday and Tuesday night, 6:30 at the ECTC Science Auditorium.
And I know people will be asking, what age ranges are you looking for?
Well, that I should know, but I did not.
Well, I'm thinking off the top of my head,
there's going to be
Anne
some young
is
people.
The youngest character,
yes.
And she's 13, 14.
Mm-hmm.
And then I think it kind of goes up from there.
Right.
You could probably go up as far as 60
yes.
or 70.
Right.
Wonderful roles.
Yes.
Wonderful story.
Yes, powerful story. And I'm looking forward to presenting this.
Looking forward to seeing it.
Good.
Yes.
Thank you very much,
You're
Carrie.
You're welcome. Y'all have
Thank
a good
you.
Day.
You too.
Next up on the program, please welcome Sarah Vaughn with the Historic State Theater.
Yay! Yay!
Kermit wave. It's so good to see you.
You too.
Happy New Year.
Yes, yes. And Happy New Year.
And here we are, brand new year. You have survived another December.
We did. We did. It was a crazy month. It was a busy month. We don't remember most of it. I mean, literally, when you talk about we did something December the 10th, and we're like, when? When was December the 10th? It was only 3 weeks ago, but it feels like a ton of years ago. But it was good. It was back to normal. It was, the building was full. It was great. It was a good month.
Very good. And so here we are, January. We are you relaxing and regrouping?
Yes. So we pick January and February as kind of the pickup time to reorganize. Our building is in complete dismay right now.
Yeah. Like everyone's house is after the holidays.
Yes. Yes. That's exactly
pine
what
needles everywhere.
It's
yes.
Glitter. Glitter is everywhere. No, it's we are renovating our space a little bit, and we try to do that at the beginning of the year because you have to clear all your rentals out. We have three different spaces to rent, and so making sure that renovations can happen within the calendar, and we try to keep it within that time frame. Because we book out sometimes 2 and 3 years at a time. And so.
Well, and January tends to be a slow month. People are regathering. There's
exactly.
Not a lot of rentals during that month. That's why we do our non-musical every January, the Sherlock we're doing right now, because that's when we can fit it in the calendar.
Awesome.
Otherwise, people are knocking on the door trying to get in.
Yes, yes, most definitely. I mean, we tried to make February our laid back month as well, so we can revamp the website and we can get those wedding photos and packages and all of the things that we've been holding off on for so long. But February is actually.
It gears up fast.
It gears up really quick.
Now, this is your 80th anniversary
yes,
of the State Theater?
Yes, thank you. The State Theater opened and was built in 1942, and it was built as a movie theater.
Uh-huh.
And it was the biggest game in town,
I
and
bet.
It was amazing. And looking through those photos, it was a family-ran and family-owned movie theater. And of course, through the years, it has opened and closed. There was a fire, and all these things have happened. And of course, the city purchased the property and rebuilt it, and a board came on and so forth. And so here we are 80 years later. We have three different spaces. Constantly renovating, constantly upgrading, and building staff. It's just, it's really cool. The atmosphere, pretty sure there's still some things in the building that's original. And so, you know, you have to deal with that. But when you go into the theater, it just takes you back in time.
Yeah, I bet. What are you doing to celebrate the 80th anniversary?
Well, we are doing a little bit of different things, and a lot of that's still in the works. But the number one thing, because the theater was built as a movie theater primarily.
I'm thinking Casablanca, 1942, somewhere around there. Mm.
You got it. We are picking movies famous for the times. So we're picking as many decades as we possibly can fit in there.
Cool.
And we're going to roll out that movie series very soon.
Oh, that's
soon.
A great idea.
Yes. Mm-hmm. So once a month, because we typically hold movies just on breaks and, you know, we don't have a set schedule, if you will. And so we'll still do those specific times.
Well, I can remember, Colton, I know you're into musicals and
yes.
stuff, and the first time I ever saw the movie Singing in the Rain was at the State Theater.
Wow.
They were showing old movies. And, you know, we get so used to seeing these things on tablets and
yeah.
TVs and
mm-hmm.
stuff, but, like, the first time you get to see The Wizard of Oz
uh-huh.
on the big screen, mm-hmm. it's an entirely different
it
experience.
Is.
So there's some of these films that they maybe bring in and that
yeah.
you've seen on TV, but you see it entirely mm-hmm. different when it's that big and blown
mm-hmm.
up.
Yes, and that's why we, for our Christmas series, we always show things like White Christmas and, you know, and showing those classics because it is. And we still have 300-500 people that show up. We also show Elf, and we also, you know, we show as many different ones as we can because it's a whole different experience. And in the 40s, it was quite something to be able to go to the movies and see those. And so we want to celebrate that history. We want to bring quite a bit of it back. So that's going to be probably the biggest celebration for the year. And of course, we'll let folks know of other things. But we do, one of the biggest goals that I personally have had and the city has had for the theater, seeing it struggle through the years, as theaters do, you know, money is always an issue, so on and so forth, is that we've wanted to see the theater become a place for promoters and folks to come in and rent the space and bring the entertainment. That's how you get the different culture. That's how you get the different diversity, instead of you know, us doing the same thing over and over. And so we are finally seeing the fruits of that labor.
Beautiful. And Real quick, what are you doing in March and April? I think you have a couple
Shows
coming
February 4th, we have tickets on sale now, is the Everly Brothers Experience.
Wonderful.
Which is just, it's going to be fantastic. So that's going to take place February the 4th. And then I had to bring my cheat sheet because our calendar is crazy right now. And then we have Hotel California Experience.
Eagles Band.
Yes.
Very nice.
You can't pass that up. That's going to be happening March the 12th. Tickets are on sale for that now. And then a week later, Confederate Railroad is going to be hitting the stage. The Confederate Railroad.
Fun.
Tickets on sale for that too. Have you heard of any of these?
Not really.
That's okay. That's okay. Tell your parents to bring you.
There you go. What were you about to ask something?
How do people get informed of more shows that are going to come?
I love you. I love you. So if you go to our Facebook page, that's probably the most up-to-date that we do, is our social media platforms, mainly on Facebook. If you like our page, we have a marketing director that she is on it. Everything is on there. And then, of course, our website, which is thestate270.org. But those are the two biggest ways to do that. We're also finally getting back to some good old organic. We're going to be emailing out some newsletters. Imagine that. We might even be mailing them out. We don't know.
Old school.
Old school. We're actually trying to listen to our clientele that says, I don't get on the internet, you know. And we still have, there are folks out there, and they're not that old, that's saying, listen, I'm not on Facebook. I'm not on, you know, and so we're trying to, doing our best to market to anyone and everyone that's out there, and still trying to stay relevant, but also meeting the needs of everyone. So
looking forward to it all.
It's going to be great. We're excited. We're hitting the ground running. And then, of course, we have the whole event side of all the outdoor festival stuff that we're gearing up for, too.
You're gearing up for the summer.
Okay. Very busy.
Cool. What's that website again?
Thestate270.org.
Thank you, Sarah.
Thanks.
Well, folks, that's going to wrap up another month of the Monthly Marquee. I'm your host, Bart Lovins, with the Hardin County Schools Performing Arts Center, and we will see you next month.
It's possible you yourself could come, Mr. Holmes.
If matters came to a crisis, I should endeavor to be present in person, but it is impossible for me to be absent from London for an indefinite time. In fact, one of the most revered names in England is being besmirched by a blackmailer, and only I can stop a disastrous scandal. No, it is impossible for me to go to Dartmoor.
Whom would you recommend, then?
Oh.